something that was not known in the past, really. They are basically observed since the 1820s, that is, after the Industrial Revolution, and in the early stages, but even nowadays, iron consumption was a good indicator of what was happening. Because iron is a product, used to be a product, which it is to some extent, which is needed everywhere as an input, directly or indirectly. And indeed, the first economic indicators of cycles, ups and downs, were based in Germany at any rate, on iron production and consumption. Now, Schumpeter. This year is the 100th anniversary of the publication of his book, Theory of Economic Development. And Schumpeter was one of the guys who argued at an early stage what is happening in capitalism is you have creation, you have novelties, but you also have a lot of destruction. What is new is not just coming in addition to what is there, but very often destroys what is there. And he coined the famous phrase of creative destruction. The process of capitalist development is a process of creative destruction. And you can't help it, you see. Capitalism generates those phases of destruction and also of construction. It is the essential fact about capitalism, it is what capitalism consists in. I think he was right. And we get, of course, different manifestations of this fact as time goes by, and in more recent times, it has a lot to do with the financial sector, which did not play that pronounced role as in the past. Now, to further quotations, which might be of some interest to you, from Beethoven, Schumpeter, cycles, I just heard the second one, cycles are not like concerts, separate things that might be treated by themselves, but are like the beat of the heart, of the essence of the organism that displays them. Therefore, the very idea of moderation, of no cycles anymore, of no crisis, is just plainly wrong, I think. And there's a difference in conceptualizing the system in which we live. On the one hand, the mainstream economics, and on the other hand, Schumpeter and all the others. Schumpeter, I think, is a non-mainstream economist, by the way. Now, I want to point out something with regard to a formula, a well-known formula of Marx's concerning the rate of profit in the system. You're all familiar with it, I suppose. And of course, this is just a formula which could be found in Keynesian theory, in any other kind of theory, because what it tells you is the rate of profits in the system, the generated profits, is nothing but total profitability as surplus value in Marx's conceptualization divided by the capital advance. Now, the capital advance is constant capital, physical capital, means of production, etc. on the one hand, and wages on the other. Now, if you reformulate this a little bit, then what you're getting is an expression. Unfortunately, this thing doesn't work. Oh, it works, sorry. Once again. Mexico is the best organized country that I've ever Everything works perfectly. So, I mean, you are the image of efficiency. Now, tell the world. So what we get in the end is what we can call the maximum rate of profits in the system under consideration. That is, if the entire social product would be distributed in the form of profits, and this would be the maximum rate, what would the system be in this regard? And then you put 1 minus W. W is the share of wages, right? And this. Now you know in Slapa, those of you who have read Slapa, you find this formula. The difference being basically that in Slapa, wages are paid at the end of the period and not the beginning. They do not count as capital. But what does it mean, this formula, this simple formula? It means, in the long run, the destiny of the rate of profit is essentially determined by 2 magnitudes. One is the maximum rate of profits, and the other one is the share of wages. These are the main determinants. Of course, there are other things, and if you look more carefully at the system, you might have to go into the matter more deeply. Now, what is going to happen to R and W as time goes by? Now, we know, of course, if the maximum rate of profits goes down,
the anticipated profits would go down. If the share of wages goes up, the rate of profits would go down. Now, the empirical evidence, more recently, according to some empirical studies by Burley and others, is that there is, on the one hand, a very pronounced tendency of the share of wages going down. In many countries, I mean, Austria, for example, very substantial drop in the share of wages and a rise in the share of profits. That is one thing. The other thing is, there's a falling tendency of the maximum rate of profits. If you describe it in terms of relationships between the rate of profits and the share of wages, there's a particular movement as time goes by. Now, these are counteracting tendencies with respect to the movement of R, and what we currently observe is the share of wages is going down, the maximum rate of profits is going down, but the rate of profits is still more or less a trendless variable. In some countries it has gone up, in others it hasn't. So now, Schumpeter, if you want to get into it, there are two publications of mine, one forthcoming shortly, which you might look up. Now, Schumpeter, let me briefly talk about Schumpeter, just to give you a vision of the modern world, which I think in some respects, not in all, is, I think, quite interesting and correct. He writes, innovations are the overwhelming fact in the history of the capitalist society. And the picture previously with the population, etc., I think demonstrates this. He talks about new combinations. New combinations is his word for innovations. And he talks about creative destruction, as we have already seen. And he emphasizes, this is important, that the economic system generates this force of development, of creative destruction from within. It is not something which is exogenous. It's not a shock, if you wish, as for example in rational expectations theory. It is from within. It is endogenous, and we have to explain how come that the system is continuously creating these changes from within. Now, of course, we know in Schumpeter there is the counterposition of the one hand between the entrepreneur. This is his hero. Schumpeter was very fond of great figures in the history, economic history. The Bill Gates, so to speak. They really changed the system. They made things move. But there is, on the other hand, of course, something you find in the classical authors and in Marx, and that is competition. The systems we live in are characterized by competition. And competition is something that compels actors to innovate in order not to be driven out of the market, or to imitate in order to stay entrepreneurs, third, etc. So the question is, what is the importance of the two? I think both are important, but I think what is more important in my view is the systemic condition, competition. Competition generates, so to speak, a drive for change and novelty. Now, interestingly enough, Schumpeter points out, as regards entrepreneurs, that they are not hedonistic people. They don't care about maximizing their utility. They are very often workaholics. You see, they can't do other than that. And they are also, as he points out, not necessarily rational in the ordinary sense at any rate. He even speaks of half pathological moments that describe their behaviors. So he has a very mixed picture of personalities that are important for the dynamics of the system, as you can see. Now, the entrepreneur awaits Sleeping Beauty. Sleeping Beauty is the steady state. You see, nothing happens. Everything is just circular and so on and so forth. But what he points out is the entrepreneurial function is not tied to the ownership of wealth. These need not be rich people. Very often they are poor people, but they have an idea. They want to translate it into an economic form, into an innovation. And therefore, he points out the overwhelming importance of the banking and credit sector. Because these people need funds in order to execute their plans. And they get those funds only via credit. And he was of the opinion that the banking system is a system which is able to generate additional credit, additional money. And therefore the system is not constrained by savings, as for example you find in Smith and in modern mainstream economics. No, it is constrained, if at all, by credit. And innovators that need to get credit to get the resources which they haven't got because they're not rich. So basically, what he argues, the banking system is the headquarters of the capitalist economy.